I'm so thrilled to be here, I can't stand still. Hi. I have a slightly awkward sound that I want to play to you. That was not the sound I mentioned. Are we kind of ready? Yeah, with the sound? Okay, so please listen carefully. There we go. Now this is the sound that you get when you connect a neuron, a brain cell, to an amplifier. And this neuron is busy sending its signal to other neurons further down in the brain. Just briefly listen to it again. Now, what does that sound mean? What kind of message is this signal conveying? What information is being transported through the neuron to other neurons in the brain? We don't know. A couple of years ago, I was at a lunch table at my university department. It's a cognitive neuroscience department. And there was a colleague of mine coming down for lunch from the lab. And she was still wearing the equipment. Basically, that's EEG equipment. That's a kind of swimming cap that you put on your head, and it's full of electrodes. And she came down, had to go back immediately. She didn't want to take it off because that takes a lot of time. And so she was eating her sandwich with the head cap on. It looked very funny. But her work is actually very important, because what she's trying to do is to help people with all kinds of muscle problems due to spine lesions, for instance, or the ALS disease, that are no longer able to move, to communicate or even move again by simply tapping into their brain signals. But things weren't really going very well, so she was kind of complaining and eating the sandwich with the head on, saying, well, if only we could have a better signal. Or if only we would know what the signal meant, then our applications would be so much better. Now, I'm a philosopher, and as a philosopher, sometimes you're allowed to skip the technical challenges. So I started thinking, well, but hang on, if we would really know what the signal means, then what would follow? Wouldn't that mean that you would actually be able to know what people think or feel, what their preferences are, what they would like to buy, for instance, or what their sexual preferences are? You know, wouldn't we be able to actually invade mental privacy? And what would that invasion of mental privacy mean for freedom of thought? So I started to become interested, and I started looking into the literature of this very developing new kind of field, and I noticed that some of the foremost researchers in that domain of brain reading, so you measure brain activity to interpret what the content of thoughts or feelings are, some of the most foremost researchers are actually suggesting that it is becoming possible. And I want to show you just a few examples so you can judge for yourself how good or how bad the state of the art currently is. Ready? Let's go. So what you see here is a video clip. The person is watching the clip on the left. At the same time, visual brain areas are active, transferring the information from the eyes into understood images. Now, there is an algorithm, much like the machine learning algorithm that was discussed earlier, and it is looking at the correlations between the brain activity on the one hand and the movie clips on the other. That's during the training phase. Then there is a test phase, and all the algorithm gets, all the computer gets, is access to the brain measurements. And it tries to reconstruct, on the basis of the brain measurements, what the image would be like that the person was seeing. You get that idea? Okay, so what you see here is the actual, on the left, the actual information, the clips that the person was seeing. On the right, you see the reconstruction of the algorithm, of the computer model, based purely on brain information. This is what it looks like. Well, what do you think? Was this good or bad? When I ask people this in general, they say a little bit of both. On the one hand, it's not that very good. You don't really see the persons in the image when it's reconstructed from brain activity. But you do see something that could be a face, more or less looking in the same direction. You didn't, for instance, see the elephant, but you saw this great kind of dusty cloud moving in the same direction as the elephant with more or less the same speed. So it's not really great, you can't really see what they're seeing, but you can make an informed guess, an educated guess. Now let's take this one step further. We go to dreams, because the same areas in the brain that are involved in seeing things are also involved in producing brain images. And this is what this looks like. Let me show you, here's time to awakening, 37 seconds. That will go down. At the end of the clip, you will see the best guess of the algorithm about what the content of the dream is, what type of objects, which categories were involved in the dream. You see them here on the screen as big letters. What do you think? Was this good or bad? What you see is that some of the information that's being displayed here actually gets back in the reports of the subjects when they are awoken out of their dream and they report the dream content. Now the images are just, you know, taken from a database, so you don't get to see what the person actually is seeing in their mental imagery, let's say, during sleep. But you can make a guess about which kind of objects are involved in the dream. Here's another example. You could see towards the end of the dream that concepts like female and male were starting to grow. So the best guess of the algorithm was that the person was dreaming about faces, male or female. And this is something that actually is confirmed by the person after the dream. How good is this? Well, you have to decide. But the problem is that this technology can have enormous implications. Well, it's not just a problem, it also provides opportunities. It can be really great in the sense that, for instance, therapists, when this finally works well, can see, for instance, the mental problems that their patients have. Or Jack Gallant suggests, for instance, that we won't have to type in messages on our smartphones anymore. We can just think our WhatsApps, or swipe to the left or to the right without using our hands. On the other hand, if you would get certain regimes with this kind of technology, and they could establish your sexual preference or your political preference, then the consequences might be really enormous. You remember George Orwell writing in 1984, nothing was your own except the few cubic centimeters inside your skull. Well, what would remain our own? It's not all that clear. So I would like to discuss the societal implications of this kind of technologies before the technology actually arrives. Am I too early with discussing this? You saw how bad it still is. It's still far away. On the other hand, I don't want to repeat the same mistake I think we made in the 90s of the last century with internet and privacy. We didn't pay very well attention to what the implications were of cookies, you know, these tracking cookies on the internet. And we lost privacy. big companies, CEOs say sometimes, you have zero privacy anyway, get over it. I wouldn't want to see that same mistake happen in relation to my inner thoughts and feelings. So that's why, rather than running the risk of starting too early, I'm willing of starting too late, I'm willing to run the risk of starting too early. So together with a colleague of mine, we're working on criteria to evaluate this technology. I will just mention one. Enforceability. Would it be possible to use this technology and actually, you know, strap you into a scanner and then measure your brain activity against your will? Would I be able to prevent it from happening? In a way, it's very easy to resist. You just start thinking about other things, or you make very small head movements, so the noise in the signal becomes very strong and there's no readable information. On the other hand, people would be able to find out that you're resisting, that you're trying to mess up the signal. There's one example of sexual preference. People were shown pictures that were, let's say, stimulating, and they were asked to control their sexual excitement. And indeed, they were capable of doing so, and you could see the brain areas involved in sexual excitement no longer being active. But you could also see the brain areas being involved in self-control lighting up. So they knew from the outside that people were trying to self-control and not do exactly as the stimuli otherwise would have done. So resistance may be possible, but it's not always necessarily effective. So in all, I hope to have shown where we stand now. It's at the very beginning, but the implications could be enormous. Brain reading is very exciting. We understand ourselves better and better, but it's also very risky. Humankind has kept on understanding itself better and better over the ages, but it's also kept threatening itself again and again over the ages. Mental privacy and freedom of thought go hand in hand. So I think it's time to start discussing the implications of this technology now. Thank you.